Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship as we gather this morning to gather in God's presence and celebrate that presence in our lives and look for ways to share God's presence in the midst of the world we live. A few announcements just want to highlight as we gather this morning. This morning in the midst of our worship, our offering is going to be part of the offering that's going to be used to be distributed to some of our frontline workers, health workers, and such this past year in the pandemic and stuff. And so the offering is going in that direction. Also, we will celebrate Holy Communion. We will distribute it in a kind of a walkthrough type format with handing the bread and then handing a cup and then of consumption. If anyone is uncomfortable at being handed to them, we do have some self-contained communion cup with the wafer and the juice in a self-contained thing that you're welcome to pick up instead of being handed to. We have a number of things in terms of prayer concerns that we lift up with both joyfully as well as in sorrow. Rosetta Storby will be baptized this afternoon at Emmanuel. Also, there was a wedding yesterday of Dre Leiberger and Randy Dilley that took place, and we celebrate with them. We extend our sympathy to Rhonda Rubitz and family as Ron's funeral will be this coming Saturday at Bethany. To Della Benson and Mark and Katie Wubin and extended family. Steve passed away. His prayer service and visitation was this past week. And then Bill and Jeannie Loberg and their extended family, as Bill's sister has died, and that is pending down the road, maybe as much as a year down the road before they will gather together. But we lift them up all in the midst of our prayers. Those who are in the throughout the parish, but particularly Joyce area, we restored the kickball again this year in terms of for young people on Wednesday evenings. Welcome to come as a meal is at 5:45, and then we play for after that. Reminder for Bethany folk, there will be a short congregational meeting sometime after we serve lunch to take care of some business. Is there anything that we'd want to, and also we have some rolls that donate from Good Shots that we want to, in the midst of our meal too. Is there anything else that we'd like to highlight, or anybody like to make mention of a few things? All right, let's begin with our worship. We begin with our welcome and our greeting. Let us be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ has forgiven us. Gracious God, we praise you for blessing us with the perfect example of your love in human form, Jesus, your Son, our Lord. He showed us the true meaning of love and forgiveness through actions shaped by grace and compassion. His anger was always a just anger, exercised when he saw people exploited and treated unjustly. He did not just imitate your love, O God, he lived it to the uttermost so that we might be empowered by your Spirit to live in love also.
We offer this time of worship and praise and thanksgiving for the blessed gift of Jesus. In his name we pray.
Amen. We continue with our songs of praise.
Thank you.
We continue with our confession. Lord Jesus Christ, as your followers, we are called to be people shaped by your ethical and selfless life, one that is so much at odds with many accepted lifestyles of today. We confess how easy it is to be drawn into these worldly lifestyles, and we need your constant help to make our behavior consistent with yours. Forgive us when our words have been less than truthful.
Inform us with your spirit so that we speak the truth, your truth, at all times.
Forgive us for using anger to manipulate and to control.
Direct us with your spirit that we might handle our anger responsibly.
Forgive us when our actions have lacked total integrity. Forgive us when our words have been thoughtless and offhand.
Instruct us with your spirit so that our words truly bring grace to those who hear.
Renew us with your spirit so that our words and actions bring you pleasure and not pain. Fall afresh on us, O Holy Spirit, and make our lives true reflections of Jesus' life, so that we live, love, and forgive as graciously and compassionately as he did. Amen. We are enabled to be kind to one another, to be tender-hearted, to forgive one another, and to be forgiven because Jesus feeds us with his life, a life given to save us from sin. Hear then the good news. Those who are in Christ are a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. Thanks be to God. At this time, we share the peace with one another. I invite you to take a look around and give one another a wave or a greeting as we see who's all at worship and welcome them as they welcome us.
The other day, I was hanging out with a friend. This friend is a Christian, but doesn't always act like one. Some days she's in line with God's word, and some days life's struggles get the best of her. As our eyes met, I really wanted to say something about it, but decided to let the Lord speak to her heart, knowing nothing I could say would have the same impact as her father's words. So I prayed with her, and after some time passed, I winked at her and walked away from the mirror.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We have a real treat for you today. Herod is right here in Jerusalem, and he has kindly agreed to address the audience and answer questions regarding his role as king. May I present Herod Antipas.
Thank you, one and all. Please don't clap. Okay, clap. What can I say? They love me.
Now, Herod, may I call you Herod?
Actually, I prefer to be called the Great One.
Great One. Tell me, how did you become King of Judea?
It's quite simple, really. I was appointed by the Roman Senate. What a bunch of great guys. Worth every bit we paid them.
One of the biggest controversies about you, as you already know, is the fact that you married your brother's wife. How were you able to get away with that?
Hey, I'm the king. Need I say more?
What does your brother say about you stealing Herodias?
Stealing is such a strong word. I prefer pocketing what should have been mine.
Didn't John the Baptist condemn your action and publicly announce that you were both in the wrong?
No, no. Like the Baptist, we don't want to lose our heads over it. Get it, huh? That reminds me of a joke. What do do John the Baptist and the horseman of Sleepy Hollow have in common? They're both headless. Get it? I got another one. Why was John the Baptist last to finish the race? He couldn't get a head. I just cracked myself up.
What is your opinion about the rumors that Jesus of Nazareth is actually John the Baptist returning from the dead?
Oh, that would be cool to see. I heard he's doing miracles like healing people, raising them from the dead, walking on water. Yes, I'd definitely like to meet him someday.
Well, you're going to have your chance. The religious leaders have captured him, and Pilate is sending him here to be questioned by you.
Really? Then let's go meet them in the main court. This is going to be good. I wonder if he'll perform a miracle for me or something. Do you think he'll like my Sleepy Hollow joke?
No one likes that joke.
I think we should go ahead and stand for the gospel lesson. You look so comfortable. The gospel lesson for this, the 11th Sunday after Pentecost, is written in the 6th chapter of the Gospel of John, beginning with the 35th verse. Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." And then the Jews began to complain about him because he said, "I am the bread that came down from heaven." And they were saying, "Is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How can he now say that I have come down from heaven?" And Jesus answered them, "Do not complain among yourselves. No one can come to me unless drawn by the Father who sent me, and I will raise that person up on the last day. It is written in the prophets that they shall all be taught by God. And everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father, except the one who is from God. He has seen the Father. Very truly I tell you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the man in the wilderness and they died. And this is the bread that comes down from heaven, so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of this world is my flesh." The gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Nicodemus became quiet and withdrew from the conversation with his friends as he thought about Jesus and his teachings. Nicodemus looked to the sea as he sat in a boat with his friends crossing the Sea of Galilee. The water sparkled with a million diamonds. The air was fresh. And Nicodemus felt him settle within, and he quoted Psalm 103 to himself. "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and let all within me bless your holy name." Nicodemus felt some peace as he praised the Lord, but his soul was still stirring from his encounters with Jesus. It started weeks ago, as he heard Jesus teach in the temple in Jerusalem. He had studied scriptures all his life in order to listen to the word of God and determine God's will for his life. But Nicodemus had never heard anyone preach and open up the scriptures like Jesus did. He was so intrigued by Jesus that he sought Jesus out in the darkness of night. And Nicodemus still pondered his conversation with Jesus. Jesus had told him that he must be born anew, born from above by the Spirit. And he still wrestled with his teachings. And when Nicodemus heard that King Herod had ordered the beheading of John the Baptist, Nicodemus had been amongst those in the crowd that had gone to see Jesus in Capernaum. Nicodemus' friends had just arrived in Capernaum when they saw Jesus and his disciples get in a boat and crossing the sea. And Nicodemus and his friends joined the crowd and quickly walked around the sea, walking up and down those sandy hills. Nicodemus was once again stirred to his very soul by Jesus' teaching. And then Jesus broke off some bread and some fish and fed him and the whole crowd. Nicodemus and his friends could not believe that there were 12 baskets of food left over after everyone ate. And Nicodemus heard the crowd start buzzing about making Jesus their king, a bread king. Nicodemus thought that Jesus was a prophet of God, but did not think that Jesus was a king, nor would Jesus want to be a bread king. And when no one could see Jesus anymore, he and his friends returned to Capernaum for the night. He and his friends talked about Jesus' teaching, the miracle of feeding everyone with 12 baskets left over. And in the morning, Nicodemus and some of his friends had asked some of the fishermen who were done cleaning their nets that they would take them across the sea as they were looking for Jesus. And when his boat was about to shore, Nicodemus started to get out of the boat when others on the land said Jesus wasn't there, that Jesus must have crossed the sea back to Capernaum. And they made room for the others in the boats, and they sailed across the sea. And as they landed on the shore, sure enough, they spotted Jesus about 100 yards down the shore from where they landed. And Nicodemus' friends led the way to Jesus and asked him, "Teacher, when did you get here?" And Jesus looked up and said, "You did not come looking for me because you saw the sign, but because you had your fill of the fish and your stomachs are full." And Nicodemus, he thought about this for a minute, and he had to agree with Jesus. They had missed a sign. They had been satisfied with the bread and the fish. And then Jesus gave another teaching that stirred his spirit, just like the night that Jesus told him that he must be born from above. Jesus said, "Do not work for food that perishes, but food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you." And another friend piped up, "Show us a sign of the work of God, that we might see and believe in you. Moses gave our ancestors manna, bread from heaven to eat." And Jesus, he sighed a sigh of patience, thought Nicodemus. And Jesus said, "It was not Moses that gave your ancestors bread to eat, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." And Nicodemus started to turn this over in his mind when Jesus continued, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But I said that to you, that you have seen me, and yet you do not believe. And everything that my Father gives me will come to me, and anyone who comes to me I will never drive away, for I have come down from heaven, not to do my own will, but to do the will of the one who sent me." And this started his friends complaining once again, especially those from Nazareth. They said loudly, "We know Jesus is the son of Joseph. We know his mother and his brothers and sisters. How can he say he came down from heaven?" And Nicodemus listened as Jesus tried once again to teach him and his friends. "It is written in the prophets, and they shall all be taught by God. And everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father, except the one who is from God. He has seen the Father. Very truly I tell you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, they died. This is the bread that came down from heaven, so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats this bread will live forever. And the bread that I will give you for the life of the world is my flesh." Whoa, that set his friends off. They were grumbling and decided to leave. Nicodemus walked with them to the top of the hill, and he told his friends to go on, and he would meet up with them later. And Nicodemus, he turned back to wait for another opportune time to talk with Jesus. Around noon, the people left for the marketplace to get food, and Jesus' disciples were heading to Peter's house. And Nicodemus approached Jesus. "Shalom, Rabbi." "Shalom. I saw you in the crowd earlier." "So this time, you came during the day, Nicodemus." And Nicodemus, he turned a little red in the face. "Yes, Jesus, I did. But like before, I have some questions. And Jesus motioned for Nicodemus to have a seat and responded, I thought as much. So go ahead, ask your questions, Nicodemus. Rabbi, Moses said that the Lord would one day send a prophet like himself. And Moses, he talked directly to God. You said earlier that it is written that they shall be taught by God. Truly, Rabbi, in all my life and all my studies, I have never heard anyone open up the promises of Scripture like you. I have witnessed you heal people from all kinds of diseases. I have seen you set people free from being possessed by demons. And like Moses, you fed us in the wilderness with great abundance. But as you said, our ancestors ate the manna from heaven, but they died. This is true. Yet you say, you are the bread that has come down from heaven. You are the living bread bringing eternal life. And Jesus nodded, letting the silence give him permission to continue on with his question. Nicodemus looked down and then back into the eyes of Jesus. Moses, he gave us the Lord's Ten Commandments. And Moses, he wrote laws, which extended the commandments into our daily lives, into our relationships with one another. And I've dedicated my whole life to studying the scriptures, studying the laws of Moses, in order to keep them the best I can. And Moses and the prophets talked to God for us. It's how we got manna. Our ancestors complained they were hungry, and God gave us manna. When Moses handed his mantle to Joshua, Joshua asked God for victory in battle, and he won. When our ancestors lived in a promised land and wandered away from God, God let our enemies oppress us. We cried out to God, and God answered. Are you not the prophet that Moses told us about, one whom God would send? You are teaching us God's word. Are we then to learn from your teachings and do some works of God, like following the laws of Moses in our lives? It seems that you are saying something different. Nicodemus has laid out the pattern of the way that the Jews, and really the way that we tend to relate to God. We, like Nicodemus, we learn the Ten Commandments. We let them inform our relationship with God and with one another. And this is good. For the Ten Commandments are indeed a blessing from our Lord. The Ten Commandments provide boundaries to protect our relationships with one another. Parents and children's relationship are protected by the boundary of honor. Our relationships with our neighbors have boundaries of protection so that we do not kill them. We do not commit adultery, do not steal their possessions or harm their character by bearing false witness or coveting their possessions or relationships with others. And if we follow these boundaries laid out in the Ten Commandments, our relationships will indeed be blessed. And the Lord calls us to follow these Ten Commandments in our lives. But from the beginning, the Ten Commandments were not the foundation of God's relationship with the people. God had declared before he gave the Ten Commandments, I will be your God, you will be my people, and I have delivered you. God has always sought a relationship of love with people and with you. Jesus came down from heaven to do his Father's will, which is to bring us into a relationship with his Father. And Jesus is able to do his Father's will, but we are not. We may be able to keep the Ten Commandments for a number of days, but then our sinful self will act out. We will sin against God and sin against one another. From the time of Adam and Eve sinned against God until the very present, we live in this brokenness that we create. Even when God sent his word like manna from heaven, those ancestors died. But Jesus is the living bread which has come down from heaven. Jesus has come down from heaven to do his Father's will, to do battle and defeat the powers of sin and death and Satan, the powers that lead to death. Jesus is the living bread and the bread of life that he has given us, is his flesh. Jesus took on the power of sin, and his friends abandoned him. He suffered rejection and mockery. He was beaten, spit upon, mocked, whipped, and crucified. And when he had taken all that sin could muster, he laid down his life into the power of death, and Jesus died. But on the third day, Jesus rose triumphant. And Jesus, he has defeated sin. Jesus has defeated death. Jesus has defeated Satan. And Jesus offers himself to us, the living bread. When Jesus was talking to the crowd, it was long before Jesus suffered the cross and died and rose again. When we hear this teaching, when we hear this teaching about living bread and eating his flesh, we think of Holy Communion. It is right to do so. For we receive the living bread that Jesus offers himself to you and me when we come forward and we open our hands. Jesus is the host, and Jesus offers you himself. Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Take and drink. It is my blood shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. And Jesus, he gives you himself. And you are the one that's eating. You are the one that's drinking. Jesus forgives you as you eat and drink. Jesus gives you his peace of being reconciled. Jesus claims you with his love. You are the one eating. You are the one drinking. Jesus is loving, forgiving, and claiming you. And Jesus has brought you into a loving, redeemed relationship with God you can call Father. Jesus has given you the gift of eternal life. For the enemies Jesus has defeated, he has defeated for you for all eternity. And you will live in the light of God and the love of God with one another, with God's perfect love. It is the gift of eternal life. But Jesus also gives you the newness of life, here and now. You eat the bread of life, here and now. You drink the blood of Christ, the covenant of forgiveness of sins, here and now. You are forgiven once again. You are given God's peace, here and now. You are claimed as God's children, here and now. God's Holy Spirit dwells within you, here and now, born of the Spirit. And since you do not have to strive to become a child of God, as the Holy Trinity has already claimed you as a child of God, Jesus calls you to live your life as a child of God. You have God's love within you now. You have the authority to forgive as you are forgiven. You have the peace of Christ to share with one another and to our neighbors. You've been blessed with the gifts and the talents by the Holy Spirit to serve the communion of saints and to bring the gospel to the world. And when you love the other in Jesus' name, you also have life. When you forgive the other in Jesus' name, you also have his peace. When you seek to love the other with God's love, you are blessed with life that builds up. Sin creates brokenness. The love of God creates life, newness of life. Jesus gives you himself, the living bread that fills your heart and overflows into all your relationships. Your relationship with God, your relationship with family and friends, your relationships with the neighbor near and far. Jesus gives you himself, the living bread come down from heaven to give you life, here and now, living in God's love, bubbling up to eternal life. Nicodemus and his friends, the religious authorities, asking Jesus questions, lived a life of faith based on a contract with God instead of God's covenant of love. They understood, if I or we keep God's law, then we can expect a blessing from God. If I break God's laws, I can expect punishment. So if I want a blessing, I can mind my P's and Q's until I get what I want from God. But Jesus, he came down from heaven doing his Father's will, drawing us into a living, loving relationship with Jesus the Father. Jesus gives us himself, the living bread, as he brings us into a redeemed relationship with the Father. Jesus, he has defeated sin. Jesus has defeated death. Jesus gives you himself. Take and eat. It is my body, which is broken for you. Take and drink. It is my blood, shed for you. And as you eat, you are once again claimed by Jesus. As you drink, you are once again forgiven by Jesus. Jesus gives you the newness of life here and now as you eat and drink. Jesus gives you life as you forgive and as you are forgiven. Jesus gives you life as you seek to love and to serve with the power and the love of the Holy Spirit dwelling within you. Jesus gives you newness of life, living in God's love now unto eternal life. Amen. The peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
At this time, we will, if there's a couple people that come forward, we have a couple buckets we'll pass around for sharing our gifts. Remember, our offerings this morning is going to the same direction that our tractor ride donations and registrations went to, and that is to show some appreciation to some of those in our communities, the frontline workers in the midst of the last year of the pandemic. So if there's a couple people that would come forward and walk some buckets around.
Thank you.
We continue with the prayers of the community, and all, as each will sing the verse, Lord, listen to your children, and then we'll sing that verse after each petition is prayed. We pray for your church in all of its diverse forms, for mission developers, for new mission starts, for our missionaries that go overseas and reach out, for all communities of faith exploring new models of ministry. We do this for the sake of the gospel. We lift up congregations also that are facing difficult decisions about their future and the future of their communities. Lord, hear our cries. Creator, we pray for the health and well-being of your creation. We pray for the shade trees that provide refuge from the hot summer sun, for lakes and rivers and oceans as they flow life into our land. Lord, we pray for rain, that it can renew the crops and the grass in our lives. Lord, may you restore your creation as you always do. Pray for all who cry out to you in their afflictions, for exiles and refugees, for others who face long and difficult journeys in the midst of their lives with uncertain futures. We pray for those who mourn the death of loved ones. We pray for those who are sick and in need of healing and recovery. Lord, we also lift up those who celebrate the gifts of life of baptism and marriage. We lift all these people into your hands. We pray for all those who are gathered here around your table, for those who receive the gifts of life through your body and blood. Lord, we also lift up in thanksgiving and with blessing the gifts that you provide us in the meal that we will share after the service. May you continue to bless us with your presence in all the ways that we share with one another, the means that nourish us in this life and the next. Let us pray together the prayer our Lord taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I invite you to join in the statement of faith. I believe in God, the creator of all life, the source of all love, the giver of every good and perfect gift. I believe in Jesus, God's only Son, who was born of a virgin birth, who lived as no other man has lived, and who suffered and died for the sin of all the world. I believe that Jesus' death and resurrection has given me new life, and I will live with him for all eternity. I believe in the Holy Spirit, God with us. I have been called by the Spirit, enlightened by the Spirit, and gifted for service by the Spirit. God is at work today, and the Holy Spirit is the vessel for God's continued love and concern for us. I believe that I can know and experience God in prayer, forgiveness, the sacraments, the fellowship of the church, and all that we do. The night in which our Lord Jesus Christ was betrayed, he took some bread, he gave thanks, he blessed it, and then he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And then again after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to all to drink. He said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. It's shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, we'll do this in a continuous style. You receive the bread and then receive one of the cups of wine. At that point, if you prefer not something to be handed to you in that way, there are some self-contained communion cups. Please just pick one of those up and then consume it accordingly. Come, for the meal has been prepared for you. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, may it strengthen you, keep you in his peace and in his grace today and forever. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue with our sending song. Just a quick instruction for lunch. I encourage you to go around the shelter and come through this way. That way you'll be with hands full, be heading to tables and your chairs for in the midst of that. So please do that. If someone, please be consider to those who might be around you that might need a hand. If they remain seated, go get their lunch and then go get your lunch, whatever works the easiest for that. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.